graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic audio presents Space Team Universe 11, Sentienced to Death by Barry J. Hutchison. Narrated by Phil Thron and performed by a full cast.
The last few months hadn't been easy for Cal Carver. In fact, it would not be an exaggeration to say they had been bordering on difficult. This tricky period had started with him being sent to prison and ended with him being blown to bits and having his guts poured back into him by a robot with a bucket. In between, he'd been tortured, shot, repeatedly stung in the face by mutant wasps, and had almost choked to death on a squirrel's tits. Add in all the running, violent travel sickness, the giant spider dragon, and a liberal sprinkling of semi-naked cannibals, and Cal felt comfortable describing the last dozen or so weeks as trying. And that didn't even include the time travel, dimension hopping, or that time he spent 50 years trapped in a single second on a cruise ship surrounded by monsters. Funking smashdown day. Still, challenging as all that had been, it was nothing compared to the situation he found himself in now. Give him the spider dragon any day. Not so much the squirrel's tits.
So...
The candlelight flickered across Lauren's pale blue skin. Cal smiled across the compact table. He had selected one of his most suave and charming smiles, but for some reason it came across as a little boggle-eyed and manic. He could feel it, too. He knew it wasn't right, and yet he couldn't for the life of him work out which parts were wrong. His hands were sweaty. He started to rub them on his thighs to dry them off, and it wasn't until Lauren's eyes flicked down that he realized quite how vigorous the rubbing motion was. He stopped, looked briefly frightened, then clasped both hands on the table in front of him between the slim metal implements he was going to go ahead and assume were a type of space cutlery he'd never encountered before.
Oh, it's hot in here.
Lauren's brow furrowed a fraction and she bit one side of her bottom lip. Funk, she was beautiful. Well, this was not news, exactly. He'd known it since the first time he'd clapped eyes on her. And yet the realization hit him like a sucker punch from Mech. Considering that Mech was an enormous, angry cyborg built almost exclusively for punching things, this was really saying something.
Are you okay? You seem kind of weird.
How weird?
Cal visibly flinched. He had meant it as a question. Now that he replayed it in his head, he realized that the words were supposed to be in completely the opposite order. Funk. This was all her fault. She'd kissed him. That was what had done it. Before the kiss, everything had been fine. He'd been able to talk to her without any problem. He'd been able to look at her without thinking about her lips on his. Been able to touch her without imagining some fantasy far-off future together where they owned a space ice cream parlor and pretended to grudge the freebies they handed out to their space grandchildren, Mikey, Mouth, Data, Chunk, and good old cousin Sloth. Yes, it was quite a specific fantasy. And yes, he'd make sure their grandchildren were named after the principal characters in the Goonies, even if it was the last thing he ever did. She raised her dark eyebrows. Cal's stomach twisted in anxious knots. Yes, the spluttering, stuttering buffoon he had become was definitely all her fault. He pulled himself together and tried the response again.
Weird? How?
That was better. With any luck, she wouldn't even notice. He smiled. At least he hoped that was what he was doing. It was becoming hard to tell. He realized he was rubbing his hands on his thighs again and returned them to the tabletop. Lauren reached over, crossing the divide between them. Her hand felt simultaneously warm and cool when she placed it on his. He wasn't sure how that was even possible, but he went with it.
Should we not do this? Was this a bad idea?
No!
Cal yanked his hands away, accidentally elbowed the head of a little green man at the table behind him, then spent several seconds offering his sincere apologies. When he turned back, Lauren continued to lean forward, her hand still on the table but just starting to withdraw. Cal pounced on it like a tiger on a luckless gazelle, pinning it to the tabletop.
Wait!
Lauren eyed him warily. It was the sort of look you gave someone during the early stages of a nervous breakdown. It was a look that said, I should probably get them help, while simultaneously acknowledging that to do so would involve quite a lot of work and general upheaval, and maybe all they needed was a strong cup of coffee and a nice sit-down. Cal relaxed his grip so that he was holding Lauren's hand as opposed to smushing it firmly into the wood of the table. She looked back at him, eyes wide and worried, head cocked just a fraction to one side. Fuck, she was beautiful.
Cal, what's wrong?
He'd had the whole speech worked out. He'd gone over it twice, once in front of the mirror and once in front of Splurt. He'd killed it both times, and that was despite the ongoing commentary from Kevin, the ship's AI, and the fact that Splurt had inexplicably taken it upon himself to turn into a child's shoe somewhere near the middle part. She gave his hand a squeeze. He could do this. He could do it.
Well,
drinks?
Cal blinked. Something orange and multi-limbed stood by the table, all six hands clasped lightly in front of a spotless white apron. Cal was confident it was a he, smiled expectantly at them both in turn, two little gills opening and closing on the sides of his neck. The question had been simple enough, but it had caught Cal off guard, and he had no idea what the man was asking.
Huh? Drinks. Would you like something to drink?
Drinks. Yes, he very much did want something to drink. Sure, the interruption hadn't come at the best possible time, but a couple of shots of alcohol would help him relax.
Yeah. Do you have, like, a beer?
A bear?
What? No, beer.
Bear.
Cal glanced across to Lauren. She was studying the weirdly transparent menu that Cal felt was trying a bit too hard to be spacey and so offered him no help.
No, not bear. Beer. B-E-E.
Bees? You wish to drink bees?
No, not bees. Why the funk would... B-E-E-R. You know, like...
He mimed sipping from a large glass.
Drinks, yes. Would you like something to drink?
We'll take a bottle of the Occlusia Norabanger.
The waiter nodded his approval.
An excellent choice.
Two of his hands produced a notebook and pencil and scribbled briefly.
Large or small?
Lauren glanced across the table to Cal.
Better make it the large.
Red or green?
Cal?
Cal stared back at her like a rabbit caught in headlights.
Hmm?
Red or green?
Cal knew what those words meant, of course. He just couldn't quite fathom out what was being asked of him or what they meant in this particular context. He decided to play it safe and just pick one, assuming there was no wrong answer. He opened his mouth. No words came out. Fuck. He couldn't pick. Red or green? Red or green what? What did Occlusion Norabanger mean? What did anything mean? Lauren and the waiter both watched him expectantly. Funk it. He was going bold.
Can we get a mixture of the two?
Lauren and the waiter exchanged slightly troubled glances.
Well, that would be a brown, sir. Also, it would get us a shutdown by the authorities.
Oh.
And the vapors would kill everybody in the room.
Bunk. Okay, let's not go for the brown.
This was stupid. He could choose. There were only two options. How hard could it be? He made a decision. Then he changed his mind midway through saying it.
Red.
We'll take the green.
Yes, excellent choice. Green. Perfect. I will go and get that for you.
He glided off. Cal glanced around the restaurant for a moment, not yet able to meet Lauren's eye. The place was decently sized, but completely packed, with tables all crammed closely together. The flickering candlelight lent it a romantic atmosphere, aided enormously by the vista of stars and moons visible through the space station's huge porthole windows. At last, Cal looked at Lauren. She was smiling quizzically at him.
So,
foaming or putrid?
Cal looked up into the smiling face of the waiter.
What?
I forgot to ask. The Eclusian Norabanger, foaming or a putrid?
Cal pulled a face.
Putrid?
The waiter looked a little taken aback, perhaps even slightly impressed. The pencil scribbled briefly.
As you wish, sir.
Wait, no, that wasn't my choice. I don't want putrid.
You don't?
No, of course I don't.
But you said putrid.
Well, yes, I said putrid, but I meant it like, holy shiz, putrid? You know, not like, I think we'll have the putrid. Obviously, we're not having the putrid.
He glanced across the table to Lauren.
We're not having the putrid, are we?
Lauren shook her head.
Thank Funk for that.
He looked back at the waiter.
We'll have the foamy.
Foaming.
Now you're just splitting hairs.
Cal gestured to the notepad.
Just do me a favor and scribble the thing in the thing and then funk off. Thank you.
Very good.
The waiter nodded as he retreated. Cal steeled himself. He scraped together a smile that he hoped didn't look all the way demented and aimed it in Lauren's direction.
Anyway.
By the way, my name is Hubert, and I will be serving you this evening.
Ah, Jesus, Hubert. Do you mind? We're trying to have a conversation here.
Hubert's face betrayed no emotion, but his gills jammed all the way open for several awkward seconds. At last, he bowed and backed away, steering himself backward through the maze of narrow tables with the effortlessness of someone who has done it too many times before. Cal started to draw in another deep breath, decided he was on the brink of coming across as some sort of heavy-breathing sex pest, and stopped. He was just going to say it. He was just going to speak aloud the words that were in his head. He'd probably play down the bit about the space grandkids and Cousin Sloth, but the rest of it he would just tell her. He'd say it aloud, they'd fall into one another's arms, and they'd live happily ever after. Easy. In fact, he'd been planning on building up to the big finale, but he was going to go ahead and lead with it. That'd make up for the past few minutes of humiliation and bumbling indecision. He was just going to hit her with those three little words. His chair creaked faintly as he leaned forward. Funk. Yes. This was it. He was doing it. This was happening. He took a deep breath. To hell with the consequences.
Lauren, I love...
I shouldn't have kissed you.
Cal swallowed a couple of times before speaking.
Hmm? I mean, yeah. That's what I was going to say.
You were?
God, yes. That's exactly what I was going to say.
It was? Why?
Why? Why?
Why? Shiz. He had no idea why. The truth was, he fundamentally disagreed on every level with what Lauren was saying. She 100% should have kissed him. Hell, he should have kissed her months ago. It was right. It was perfect.
It just felt wrong.
No. What was he saying? This wasn't the plan. Lauren seemed to shrink just a fraction.
It did? I mean, yes, it did. Just wrong.
So wrong.
He tapped his finger on the tabletop a few times.
So very wrong.
Lauren nodded in that efficient way of hers. It was a military nod, Cal thought. A curt snapping forward of the head that signified that she concurred. It was a nod that wasted nothing. Funk, she was beautiful.
You and me, like that, it would just be...
weird. I mean, weird can be good, but no.
He shuddered in revulsion.
Ugh.
Ugh.
Why the funk had he said ugh? He didn't mean ugh. He meant the opposite of ugh. And as for the shudder of disgust...
Exactly. Plus, you know, Miz might be upset.
Right. Right.
Cal was still nodding, he realized, but he couldn't quite work out how to stop.
I mean, I'm sure she'd be fine with it. I'm pretty sure she doesn't like me in that way anymore, but... yep, exactly. Poor Miz.
We couldn't do that to her.
It'd just be cruel. If she cared. Which I don't think she does, but if she did, it'd just be cruel.
Silence fell in the gulf between them. Cal knew he should say something, but no matter how desperately he grasped for a conversation starter, he came back empty. This was unusual for him. He'd always considered his ability to just talk as one of his core skills. No matter the company, no matter the situation, he'd always been able to find something to say. Granted, much of it was nonsense, and the actual words that came out of his mouth often resulted in him being beaten or chased, but it had always been one of his defining qualities. Now, though, words deserted him. That, however, was all about to change.
Oh, Jesus! What the funk is that smell?
What smell?
That smell. Can't you smell that?
The look on Lauren's face told him that, yes, she could, while also telling him that he should shut the funk up right now.
Huh! Smells like irritable bowel syndrome just chizzed out her sewer system. I mean, Christ! It's like a skunk had a rectal prolapse then died!
Lauren's eyes flicked very deliberately to something behind Cal. Something quite large, judging by her gaze's upward trajectory. Cal's own eyes were watering so badly, though, that he didn't pick up on it.
Guys, like Detroit farted and then followed through.
Cal?
It's like someone tried to put out a dumpster fire with cat vomit.
Cal?
Cal blinked away his tears and finally met Lauren's gaze. It took him a moment, but then he understood the significance of the way her eyes kept flicking up somewhere above his head. Way above his head.
And yet...
He wafted a hand in front of his face.
It is not without a certain robust charm.
A hand was placed on his shoulder. It was a big hand, and so heavy that it almost toppled him out of his chair. The smell that emanated from the bristly black fur assaulted him, easily violating the nostrils he had been attempting to clench tightly shut. It was fish heads in the sun, month-old garbage. The hot dog he'd eaten in Mumbai, which, upon closer inspection some 20 minutes later, turned out not to have been a hot dog at all, except perhaps in the most literal sense.
You say something.
It's fine. He didn't mean anything by it.
I'll decide if it's fine.
The weight on Cal's shoulder increased as the unseen person leaned down until his face was close to Cal's ear.
And it ain't fine.
Cal, this is a Gnarlup. Their odors are of great personal importance to them. They take pride in their scent.
Right. It's just, it's so musky. It took me by surprise, that's all.
Steeling himself, he turned to face the foul-smelling creature. The voice was male, but the face was decidedly ambiguous. It was flat and wide, with leathery patches on the cheeks and chin, eyes that slanted up at 45-degree angles, and a nose so small and insignificant that it needn't really have bothered showing up. The rest of the head was a blend of short black and gray fur, with a couple of fleshy ears flopping outward like overripe bananas at the sides, all sickly yellow and patches of brown. And it was big, as heads went. Bigger than Max, Cal calculated, and that guy had a sizable funking head. Cal's initial reaction was to punch the face as hard as he could and then run away screaming. But he forced himself to remain seated and rustled up an expression that he hoped came across as suitably friendly.
Look, how about I buy you a drink as a way of an apology? I hear this place does a great putrid. Lauren?
Occlusion Norabanger.
That, yes, thank you. We could buy you one of those, put all this unpleasantness behind us, and go about our business happier, wiser, and I'm gonna go right ahead and say what we're all thinking. Better people than we were before. What do you say?
The Gnarlup said nothing. Instead, a dozen or so little holes opened like tiny anuses in his fur. A smell hit Cal like a bomb blast to the olfactory centers of his brain. He didn't so much recoil as physically shrink, every part of him tightening and constricting as his lungs and airways went into lockdown, and the rest of his body joined in to show its moral support. The smell wasn't just bad, it was somehow insulting. It was an affront to all other smells that Cal had ever smelled. Even Paris. Okay, maybe not Paris, but every other smell. Cal tried to wheeze an, oh well, another time maybe, but his mouth remained firmly shut, and his breathing apparatus was still firmly opting out. Despite this, the smell was still finding its way through. He could feel it filling him up, permeating all his permeable parts, and almost certainly riddling him with cancer.
Let him go. Now.
Cal looked across at the blurry shape that he guessed was Lauren. It was hard to make her out properly, thanks to the way his eyes were watering. He was also fairly certain that the left eye was in the process of melting, which wasn't exactly helping matters. Cal projectile vomited into the Narlup's face.
Oh, God. I'm so sorry.
Another eruption of barf blasted through the gaps between his fingers, applying a glossy top coat to the already well-covered face of the Narlup. The Narlup blinked several times, each time more slowly than the one before. Vomit clagged in his fur and dribbled down his chin. Cal took a moment to compose himself and make sure he wasn't going to throw up a third time.
So, what happens now?
Now?
His grip tightened on Cal's shoulder. There was a moment of pain, a sensation of weightlessness, and then there was a table. It was not his and Lauren's table, but another table that was much larger and farther away. He hit it with quite considerable force, smiling apologetically as he skidded through several delicious-looking dinners, then his face got acquainted with the lap of an elderly woman who winked salaciously at him when he looked up.
Now I kill you.
Cal wasn't a fan of fighting, which was ironic, really, considering how often he found himself involved in one. It wasn't that he didn't enjoy being punched in the face. He didn't, obviously, but that wasn't the main reason for his dislike of violence. Similarly, while he wasn't the world's biggest fan of being kicked in the nuts, elbowed in the kidneys, or thrown ass-first through a wall, none of these were the main issue he had with violence. The main reason he wasn't a fan of fighting was that he didn't actually like hitting people. Yes, he accepted that it was often a necessary evil, and that some people occasionally needed to find themselves on the receiving end of a solid punch to the face, but enjoy it? No. He especially didn't enjoy hitting people who smelled like a corpse's diarrhea and were dripping vomit all over the floor. He'd go so far as to say he actively disliked that, in fact, and yet, here they were. The Narlup was, to Cal's relief, not quite as solid as he looked. Punching him still felt like driving a fist into a bag of cement, granted, but it wasn't the brick wall Cal had been bracing himself for. In fact, the Narlup's torso was soft and pliable enough that Cal decided he might even punch him again, just as soon as the bones in his hands had knitted back together. Before either of these things could happen, the Narlup hit him back. The force of it flipped Cal two-thirds of the way through what would have been a textbook backflip before the top of his skull found the edge of a table and the whole maneuver just sort of folded to an untidy end. As he lay there, Cal reconsidered the reasons he didn't enjoy fighting and moved the getting hit part up into the number one position. He also inserted it into positions 2 through 9, with the hitting people back bit just hanging on in there and rounding out the top 10. His head hurt. His back hurt. His fist hurt. The room swam in giddy circles around him, and he wasn't entirely convinced that he still had a face. Not a functioning one, at least. Not one that wouldn't make women scream and small boys gawp in mute, horrified wonder, at any rate. Fortunately, he healed quickly. Unfortunately, not quickly enough. The Narlup's grip tightened around his ankle. Cal cartwheeled through the air like the throwing star of some giant ninja. He briefly locked eyes with Lauren as he passed her, upside down, then hit one of the ornate marble columns that stood spaced out around the restaurant. The restaurant itself was pretty much empty now, most sensible people having made a break for it when the fighting kicked off. The even more sensible ones had taken a moment to grab their dinner plates and whatever alcohol they could carry before fleeing the scene, safe in the knowledge that no one could possibly blame them for getting out of there without paying, given all the violence and wanton destruction that had been going on around them at the time. Only a few stragglers remained. They lurked near the exits, watching the battle with a growing sense of fascination. Both combatants had things going for them. The Gnarlup was bigger, faster, and much stronger, but the human had a real talent for taking a punch. He could also scream in a surprisingly high register, and the sheer range of facial expressions he was demonstrating were, they all agreed, a genuine joy to behold. No one was saying they were evenly balanced, of course, just that they both had their strengths. Cal slid down the column, leaving a slug trail of blood, snot, and tears on its otherwise pristine white stone. He sat down heavily on the floor, flopped backward, and spent a few seconds admiring some impressive ceiling cornicing before a foot stamped into his stomach, folding him up at the middle and ejecting the last remnants of air out of him at both ends. It was one indignity too far. His lungs declared themselves out. They'd had enough. He tried to stand, but his spine was refusing to carry the message to his legs, and it was all he could do to twitch. His eyes were working, although he dearly wished that they weren't, as they only served to afford him a clear, uninterrupted view of the Gnarlup's foot raising again.
Oh, Jesus.
Lauren fired a kick into the knee of the Gnarlup's supporting leg, and he was sent stumbling through a table.
Stand down.
She positioned herself between Cal and the Gnarlup. Her hands weren't raised, but instead hung loosely by her sides. Cal knew this meant nothing. Unlike him, Lauren enjoyed fighting, probably because she was so damned good at it.
Out of my way, you malodorous pair of teats.
Lauren's eyebrows raised.
I'm sorry.
Teats.
The Gnarlup's face anuses, or fanuses, as Cal was choosing to call them, albeit only inside his head, opened and closed, parping out a chorus of toxic guffs. Lauren held her ground. Cal was impressed. He was farther away than she was, and it was all he could do not to cave in his own nose in a desperate attempt at self-preservation.
You heard me. Teats.
Lauren's arms no longer looked quite as relaxed as they had a moment ago. That was the first thing Cal noticed. The next thing he noticed was the leaping, spinning kick, and the way the heel of Lauren's boot so firmly introduced itself to the side of the Gnarlup's head. After that, Cal mostly noticed the way the creature's eyes swelled up and the expression of shocked outrage written all over its vomit-stained face. Lauren wasn't really one for overt celebration, so she settled for a firm nod of triumph.
Now who's a pair of...
A scything backhand from the Gnarlup caught her off guard. It lifted her off her feet, whistled her through the air, then wrapped her around another of the marble columns. Okay, that did it. Cal heaved himself into a standing position. This took quite a lot of effort, and he was forced to lean against the column for a few moments while he got his breath back. The Gnarlup, to his credit, waited.
Thanks. Listen, pal, no one hits my...
He jabbed a thumb in Lauren's direction as she flipped up onto her feet.
Friend, or, you know, whatever.
Bending, Cal retrieved his jacket from where it lay on the floor. He had refused the restaurant's offer to hang it up for him and had insisted on keeping it close at hand. Now everyone would find out why. He smiled as he bunched the brown leather into a ball.
You asked for this, you big smelly funk. Go get him, splurt!
The jacket hit the Gnarlup, bounced off, and landed in a heap on the floor. Cal eyed it eagerly.
Get him, buddy. Show this funk who's boss.
The Gnarlup looked down at the jacket. He was about to step over it when Cal raised a hand.
Wait, hold on.
He squinted down at the jacket, then prodded it with his foot.
Splurt? Is that you?
The jacket offered nothing in response.
Ah, shiz.
Cal looked down at himself, then raised a foot and hopped on the spot as he undid the laces of his right boot.
Maybe he's one of these?
You told him not to come.
Lauren hobbled up to stand at Cal's side.
I know I told him not to come. I always tell him not to come, but he comes anyway. That's like his thing. You say, please don't come, Splurt. He just ignores you and comes regardless. If there's one thing I can count on, is for Splurt to come places I don't want him to come. He just comes everywhere.
Children present!
Cal replayed his last few sentences in his head, then wheeled around to face the woman who had spoken.
Jesus! I didn't mean it like that!
He gestured to the two young children standing wide-eyed beside her.
And why are you even letting your kids watch this anyway? Are you trying to desensitize them to violence or something? Because if so...
The Nala punched him so hard on the back of the head, he had to shut his eyes to prevent them from popping out. Because he had his eyes closed, the floor took him by surprise when he pendulumed onto it, his feet remaining mostly fixed to the spot while the rest of him swung around them like a hinge. Anger flooded through him. This guy had gone far enough. Rolling onto his back, Cal attempted one of Lauren's martial arts-style kip-up moves. He'd always admired the way she could flip to a standing position from flat on her back, and reckoned he'd seen her do it enough times to have a pretty good idea how it was done. He kicked his legs and managed to raise his shoulders a full 3 inches off the floor before thudding back onto it. Seen from above, he resembled a fish on the deck of a boat, frantically flailing and flopping around as it tried to figure out what the funk just happened to the world and why its eyeballs were drying out.
Funk, that's harder than it looks.
The Gnarlup stood over him, watching in amusement. His arms were crossed across his broad chest, which Cal was pleased about. If his arms were crossed, it meant he wasn't using them to pummel Cal's face into the floor. Right now, he had to take the positives where he could find them.
Looks like we're pretty evenly matched, friend.
No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't. Fine, you win. How about we call a truce?
The Gnarlup raised an eyebrow, although you had to look very closely to see it, since most of him was basically eyebrow. He pursed his lips, then a smile tugged at the corner of his mouth.
Fine.
He unfolded his arms and reached out a hand.
You can buy me that drink.
Then you can call me an ambulance.
It was at this point that the edge of a flying metal drink tray whanged across the Gnarlup's stubby nose, shattering the bone and ejecting a fountain of blood onto the floor. He staggered back, both huge hands covering his face.
Oh, bunk.
Cal sat up and twisted.
Lauren, wait!
But it was too late. He watched from below as Lauren sailed over him, leg outstretched, foot aimed squarely at the Gnarlup's chest. She hit him with the force of a small yet efficient battering ram, the kick driving the air out of him and turned his stagger into a stumble, then a fall, then a splintering of wood and shattering of crockery as he crashed through a table. Lauren stood before the chaos, dusting off her hands and looking pretty darned pleased with herself. Cal got to his feet beside her. She smiled at him.
Well, way to go, Lauren.
What? I got him.
Lauren gestured to the fallen Gnarlup.
He was surrendering. I talked him into giving up.
Lauren regarded the Gnarlup, then turned his attention back to Cal.
You did?
Cal nodded slowly.
Oh.
Lauren chewed her lip.
Are you sure?
I'm sure.
Oh.
She considered this some more, then shrugged.
If you ask me, he had this coming. He was out of line. It was only right that I taught him a lesson and took him down.
Only, Cal realized, the Gnarlup wasn't down. Not any longer, at any rate. He rose up beside them, eyes blazing, teeth bared, fanuses puckered. While the Gnarlup had been violently pummeling him, Cal had been under the impression that the guy was angry. Now, though, he was reconsidering that opinion. Back then, he reckoned, the Gnarlup had been irritated, peeved at worst. Now he was angry. You could tell by the way his face was all twisted and his muscles were all tensed.
I'm going to fucking kill you both!
Not sure he learned that lesson, Lauren.
He and Lauren threw themselves in opposite directions as the Gnarlup charged, his fists spinning like windmills, driving his foul stench ahead of him. On the Gnarlup's right, Lauren rolled expertly into a fighting stance. On its left, Cal got his ass wedged between the legs of an upturned space chair and spent several seconds muttering to himself as he tried to get free. The Gnarlup stopped. The Gnarlup turned. And then, to everyone's surprise, the Gnarlup exploded. Or rather, bits of him did. Unfortunately for him, they were quite important bits. His chest went first, erupting outward as if he was a giant birthday cake, and his heart was the stripper lurking inside. His face registered his own feelings of surprise at this, and then it exploded too, showering the room with fragments of skull, lumps of brain, and what Cal now considered to be the worst smell he had ever had the misfortune of inhaling. Or second worst, if you counted Paris. Cal and Lauren watched as the headless, chestless corpse crumpled itself into a pile on the floor between them. Thick, viscous blood pumped from the wounds, forming a slowly expanding pool. Floating atop it, a lightly scorched Phaenis parked for the final time. All this had happened in a sort of slow-motion haze. Cal had watched the exploding Gnarlup with a sense of dreamlike wonder, like a child watching a particularly impressive magic trick. And now, like a child in the seconds immediately after a particularly impressive magic trick, he tried to figure out how it had been done. The answer didn't take long to present itself.
Sirtex.
Lauren sidestepped through the blood and gore until she was closer to Cal. He had successfully extracted his ass from the upturned chair, but hadn't yet made it as far as standing. The threatening manner in which one of the two uniformed men in the doorway was pointing a blaster rifle in his direction told him that now probably wasn't the time to get up. From the corner of his eye, he saw the woman and her children watching on.
Seriously, lady? You're still looking? Well, don't come crying to me when those kids start having night terrors and then murder you in your sleep. That's all on you.
Silence. Stop talking.
The armed man's uniform was a series of maroons and grays, reinforced in most of the vital areas by a thin, flexible armor that looked like it wouldn't stop a well-aimed snowball, let alone a blaster round. Of course, it wasn't just armor, Cal knew. It was space armor, and the rules were almost certainly different. You could probably drop the Fonker into a volcano and he'd come out unscathed. Well, except his head, which appeared to be completely unprotected. The rest of him would almost certainly be fine, though. The man beside him was dressed identically, but with the addition of a shiny metal stripe along the top of his chest plate, which Cal guessed signified some sort of officer ranking. Either that or the store had neglected to remove the security tag when he'd bought it.
Oh, God! Officers, thank goodness you're here!
Cal widened his eyes and smiled in a way that managed to be friendly, concerned, and yet entirely deferential all at the same time. Both Zyrtec guards glanced around at the ruined restaurant. Their guns remained trained, one on Lauren, the other on Cal, as they advanced in formation, picking their way through the discarded crockery, upturned torso, and crispy fried body parts.
There we were, minding our own business, enjoying the hospitality of this lovely restaurant when this gentleman began.
He wiped an imaginary tear from his eye and looked up at Lauren.
Well, he went crazy, didn't he, darling?
Lauren's brow furrowed for a moment, then she nodded.
Yeah, he went crazy.
The Zyrtec guards stopped in front of them, their faces fixed in some sort of regulation sneer. Now that they were closer up, Cal could see that their heads were protected after all. A 99% transparent bubble sprouted from the necks of their armor, completely encasing their skulls. As they breathed, tiny patches of fog appeared on the inside, before evaporating away again.
Who are you?
The guard with the shiny stripe lowered his gun, but only by a fraction.
Show me your ID.
Cal raised his hands by his head and raised himself up onto his knees. Once he was sure no one was about to blast his face off, he began to pat his pockets.
Yes, of course. ID. ID. Now, where did I put that blasted?
Cal didn't like fighting, but then he didn't like Zyrtec either. and he liked having a gun pointed at him even less. That was why he took a little pleasure, not much, but a little, when he twisted suddenly, putting as much of his weight as possible behind an uppercut that rose quickly, then stopped when it found the testicles of the man before him. There was some reinforcement in the guard's crotch area, but clearly, whoever had designed the armor hadn't been prepared for a strike from that particular angle. The force of it lifted him a full inch and a half off the floor, and by the time his partner had figured out what was happening, Lauren had driven a palm strike into his solar plexus. He fumbled with his gun, but Lauren kicked one of his knees outward, hammered a flurry of punches into his stomach, then twisted his wrist until the weapon fell from his grip. Meanwhile, Cal's guy clutched at his abdomen and threw up against the inside of his barely visible visor. His view partly blocked, the guard fired wildly, obliterating one of the decorative stone columns and filling the air with plaster dust. Cal tackled the guard by both legs, knocking him over. As the guard went down, Cal jumped up. He turned to Lauren, his face all sparkling eyes and beaming grin.
What'd he say?
He held a hand out to her.
Run?
Lauren nodded. Her hand slipped into his. So cool, so warm, so Lauren.
Yeah, let's run.
They raced past the guards, bounded over the headless body of the Narlup, and skidded through his blood as they charged toward the exit. As they passed, the woman by the doorway placed her webbed hands over the eyes of the children beside her, so all Cal could see was the little circles of mute horror that were their mouths.
Oh, sure, now they look away. Seriously, lady, worst mother ever.
If she answered, he didn't hear it. He and Lauren stumbled out through the restaurant door, skidded into the corridor, and then stopped when they saw the squadron of six Zyrtex shock troopers sprinting toward them, electric shock rods at the ready.
That's not good.
Cal looked down at his shirt, pants, and both boots, one of which was still untied.
Splurt! You there, buddy?
His clothes steadfastly remained just clothes.
Ah, fuck.
And then they ran. Word had gotten around that the shock troops were on the warpath. The corridors on this floor had been reasonably quiet on the way to the restaurant, but now they were all but deserted, with only the distant ka-thunk of slamming doors signaling that anyone else was here. Cal and Lauren skidded around a bend, ducking as an electro blast scorched the window behind them. The window stretched from ceiling to floor and ran ahead for hundreds of feet, fully replacing one entire wall. Outside, space was hanging around in that way that space so often did. Stars, planets, a sun, that sort of thing. Once upon a time, the view would have blown Cal's mind. Nowadays, though, he barely even noticed it other than in a general, ooh, space sort of way. Besides, he was too concerned about his mind being blown in a much more literal sense right now to take time out to admire the scenery. Lauren grabbed Cal by the wrist and pulled him into a lurching stagger a split second before the air popped and fizzled beside them. They both watched the electroblast streak ahead and winced as it detonated against the smooth, curved glass. Fuck, that was close.
Shoot them! Why aren't you shooting them?
I don't have my gun.
Why don't you have your gun?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.